Audio Renaissance presents The Shock Doctrine, The Rise of Disaster Capitalism by Naomi Klein, read for you by Jennifer Wiltsie.
Introduction. Blank is beautiful. 3 decades of erasing and remaking the world. I met Jamar Perry in September 2005 at the big Red Cross shelter in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Dinner was being doled out by grinning young Scientologists, and he was standing in line. I had just been busted for talking to evacuees without a media escort and was now doing my best to blend in, a white Canadian in a sea of African-American Southerners. I dodged into the food line behind Perry and asked him to talk to me as if we were old friends, which he kindly did. Born and raised in New Orleans, he'd been out of the flooded city for a week. He looked about 17, but told me he was 23. He and his family had waited forever for the evacuation buses. When they didn't arrive, they had walked out in the baking sun. Finally, they ended up here, a sprawling convention center, normally home to pharmaceutical trade shows and capital city carnage, the ultimate in steel cage fighting. Now jammed with 2,000 cots and a mess of angry, exhausted people being patrolled by edgy National Guard soldiers just back from Iraq. The news racing around the shelter that day was that Richard Baker, a prominent Republican congressman from this city, had told a group of lobbyists, "We finally cleaned up public housing in New Orleans. We couldn't do it, but God did." Joseph Cannizzaro, one of New Orleans' wealthiest developers, had just expressed a similar sentiment. "I think we have a clean sheet to start again, and with that clean sheet, we have some very big opportunities." All that week, the Louisiana State Legislature in Baton Rouge had been crawling with corporate lobbyists helping to lock in those big opportunities. Lower taxes, fewer regulations, cheaper workers, and a smaller, safer city, which in practice meant leveling the public housing projects and replacing them with condos. Hearing all the talk of fresh starts and clean sheets, you could almost forget the toxic stew of rubble, chemical outflows, and human remains just a few miles down the highway. Over at the shelter, Jamar could think of nothing else. "I really don't see it as cleaning up the city. What I see is that a lot of people got killed uptown. People who shouldn't have died." He was speaking quietly, but an older man in line in front of us overheard and whipped around. "What is wrong with these people in Baton Rouge? This isn't an opportunity, it's a goddamn tragedy. Are they blind?" A mother with 2 kids chimed in. "No, they're not blind, they're evil. They see just fine." One of those who saw opportunity in the floodwaters of New Orleans was Milton Friedman, grand guru of the movement for unfettered capitalism and the man credited with writing the rulebook for the contemporary hypermobile global economy. 93 years old and in failing health, Uncle Milty, as he was known to his followers, nonetheless found the strength to write an op-ed for the Wall Street Journal 3 months after the levees broke. "Most New Orleans schools are in ruins," Friedman observed, "as are the homes of the children who've attended them. The children are now scattered all over the country. This is a tragedy. It is also an opportunity to radically reform the educational system." Friedman's radical idea was that instead of spending a portion of the billions of dollars in reconstruction money on rebuilding and improving New Orleans' existing public school system, the government should provide families with vouchers, which they could spend at private institutions, many run at a profit, that would be subsidized by the state. A network of right-wing think tanks seized on Friedman's proposal and descended on the city after the storm. The administration of George W. Bush backed up their plans with tens of millions of dollars to convert New Orleans schools into charter schools, publicly funded schools run by private entities according to their own rules. Charter schools are deeply polarizing in the United States, and nowhere more than in New Orleans, where they are seen by many African American parents as a way of reversing the gains of the civil rights movement, which guaranteed all children the same standard of education. For Milton Friedman, however, the entire concept of a state-run school system reeked of socialism. In his view, the state's sole functions were, to protect our freedom both from the enemies outside our gates and from our fellow citizens, to preserve law and order, to enforce private contracts, to foster competitive markets. In other words, to supply the police and the soldiers. Anything else, including providing free education, was an unfair interference in the market. In sharp contrast to the glacial pace with which the levees were repaired and the electricity grid was brought back online, the auctioning off of New Orleans' school system took place with military speed and precision. Within 19 months, with most of the city's poor residents still in exile, New Orleans' public school system had been almost completely replaced by privately run charter schools. Before Hurricane Katrina, the school board had run 123 public schools. Now, it ran just 4. Before that storm, there had been 7 charter schools in the city. Now, there were 30. New Orleans teachers used to be represented by a strong union. Now the union's contract had been shredded and its 4,700 members had all been fired. New Orleans was now, according to the New York Times, the nation's preeminent laboratory for the widespread use of charter schools. While the American Enterprise Institute, a Friedmanite think tank, enthused that Katrina accomplished in a day what Louisiana school reformers couldn't do after years of trying. Public school teachers, meanwhile, watching money allocated for the victims of the flood being diverted to erase a public system and replace it with a private one, were calling Friedman's plan an educational land grab. I call these orchestrated raids on the public sphere in the wake of catastrophic events, combined with the treatment of disasters as exciting market opportunities, disaster capitalism. Friedman's New Orleans op-ed ended up being his last public policy recommendation. He died less than a year later, on November 16, 2006, at age 94. Privatizing the school system of a mid-size American city may seem like a modest preoccupation for the man hailed as the most influential economist of the past half century, one who counted among his disciples several U.S. presidents, British prime ministers, Russian oligarchs, Polish finance ministers, third world dictators, Chinese Communist Party secretaries, International Monetary Fund directors, and the past 3 chiefs of the U.S. Federal Reserve. Yet his determination to exploit the crisis in New Orleans to advance a fundamentalist version of capitalism was also an oddly fitting farewell from the boundlessly energetic 5-foot-2-inch professor who, in his prime, described himself as an old-fashioned preacher delivering a Sunday sermon. For more than 3 decades, Friedman and his powerful followers had been perfecting this very strategy. Waiting for a major crisis or shock, then selling off pieces of the state to private players while citizens were still reeling from the shock, then quickly making the reforms permanent. In one of his most influential essays, Friedman articulated contemporary capitalism's core tactical nostrum, what I have come to understand as the shock doctrine. He observed that only a crisis, actual or perceived, produces real change. When that crisis occurs, the actions that are taken depend on the ideas that are lying around. That, I believe, is our basic function, to develop alternatives to existing policies, to keep them alive and available until the politically impossible becomes politically inevitable. Some people stockpile canned goods and water in preparation for major disasters. Friedmanites stockpile free market ideas. And once a crisis has struck, the University of Chicago professor was convinced that it was crucial to act swiftly, to impose rapid and irreversible change before the crisis-racked society slipped back into the tyranny of the status quo. Friedman first learned how to exploit a large-scale shock or crisis in the mid-70s, when he acted as advisor to the Chilean dictator General Augusto Pinochet. Not only were Chileans in a state of shock following Pinochet's violent coup, but the country was also traumatized by severe hyperinflation. Friedman advised Pinochet to impose a rapid-fire transformation of the economy. Tax cuts, free trade, privatized services, cuts to social spending and deregulation. Eventually, Chileans even saw their public schools replaced with voucher-funded private ones. It was the most extreme capitalist makeover ever attempted anywhere, and it became known as a Chicago school revolution, since so many of Pinochet's economists had studied under Friedman at the University of Chicago. Friedman predicted that the speed, suddenness, and scope of the economic shifts would provoke psychological reactions in the public that facilitate the adjustment. He coined a phrase for this painful tactic, economic shock treatment. In the decades since, whenever governments have imposed sweeping free market programs, the all-at-once shock treatment or shock therapy has been the method of choice. Pinochet also facilitated the adjustment with his own shock treatments. These were performed in the regime's many torture cells, inflicted on the writhing bodies of those deemed most likely to stand in the way of the capitalist transformation. Many in Latin America saw a direct connection between the economic shocks that impoverished millions and the epidemic of torture that punished hundreds of thousands of people who believed in a different kind of society. Exactly 30 years after such forms of shock descended on Chile, the formula reemerged with far greater violence in Iraq. I started researching the free market's dependence on the power of shock 4 years ago, during the early days of the occupation of Iraq. After reporting from Baghdad on Washington's failed attempts to follow their shock and awe military doctrine with shock therapy, I traveled to Sri Lanka several months after the devastating 2004 tsunami and witnessed another version of the same maneuver. Foreign investors and international lenders had teamed up to use the atmosphere of panic to hand the entire tropical coastline over to entrepreneurs, who quickly built large resorts, blocking hundreds of thousands of fishing people from rebuilding their villages near the water. In a cruel twist of fate, nature has presented Sri Lanka with a unique opportunity, and out of this great tragedy will come a world-class tourism destination, the Sri Lankan government announced. By the time Hurricane Katrina hit New Orleans and the nexus of Republican politicians, think tanks, and land developers started talking about clean sheets and exciting opportunities, it was clear that this was now the preferred method of advancing corporate goals, using moments of collective trauma to engage in radical social and economic engineering. Most people who survive a devastating disaster want the opposite of a clean slate. They want to salvage whatever they can and begin repairing what was not destroyed. They want to reaffirm their relatedness to the places that formed them. "When I rebuild the city, I feel like I'm rebuilding myself," said Cassandra Andrews, a resident of New Orleans' heavily damaged Lower Ninth Ward, as she cleared away debris after the storm. But disaster capitalists have no interest in repairing what was. In Iraq, Sri Lanka, and New Orleans, the process deceptively called reconstruction began with finishing the job of the original disaster by erasing what was left of the public sphere and rooted communities, then quickly moving to replace them with a kind of corporate New Jerusalem, all before the victims of war or natural disaster were able to regroup and stake their claims to what was theirs. Mike Battles puts it best. "For us, the fear and disorder offered real promise." The 34-year-old ex-CIA operative was talking about how the chaos in Iraq had helped his unknown and inexperienced private security firm, Custer Battles, to shake roughly $100 million in contracts out of the federal government. "When I began this research into the intersection between super profits and mega disasters, I thought I was witnessing a radical change in the way the drive to liberate markets was advancing around the world. Having been part of the movement against ballooning corporate power that made its global debut in Seattle in 1999, I was accustomed to seeing similar business-friendly policies imposed through arm-twisting at World Trade Organization summits, or as the conditions attached to loans from the International Monetary Fund. The three trademark demands, privatization, government deregulation, and deep cuts to social spending, tended to be extremely unpopular with citizens. But when the agreements were signed, there was still at least the pretext of mutual consent between the governments doing the negotiating, as well as a consensus among the supposed experts. Now, the same ideological program is being imposed via the most baldly coercive means possible. Under foreign military occupation after an invasion, or immediately following a cataclysmic natural disaster. September 11th appeared to have provided Washington with the green light to stop asking countries if they wanted the U.S. version of free trade and democracy and to start imposing it with shock and awe military force. As I dug deeper into the history of how this market model had swept the globe, however, I discovered that the idea of exploiting crisis and disaster has been the modus operandi of Milton Friedman's movement from the very beginning.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.